There is a specter haunting Victoria 3, the specter of the default construction sector AI. Welcome back to We Play Games. I'm Walker, and here we are in the default construction sector AI in Victoria 3. This is meant more as a conversation trying to inform you about the way the AI approaches how many construction sectors it has, but more importantly, I'm going to show you how to modify it in a way that I think makes the game a lot more flavorful, makes it play a lot better, gives a lot more agency to very specific countries in the world without necessarily destabilizing the game. So one of the things in Victoria 3 that's kind of always bothered me is that there are some countries like Argentina that almost became superpowers, or, you know, maybe a major power during this time frame, that largely do not do anything throughout the course of the game. Part of this, of course, is due to the size of the economy of Argentina at game start. And then part of it, of course, is informed by the economic strategies that it chooses. If it's choosing a strategy that's inherently going to be making landowners more powerful, it's going to be making itself less powerful. But more than that, more than anything else, is the fact that the AI currently does not check its investment pool to determine the size of its construction sectors. This is important because it means that there's going to be fewer construction sectors floating around in the world, especially for smaller or mid-sized economies that do not yet have the resources in terms of its GDP or its population to support a larger construction sector. And so it means smaller and more efficient economies can't really catch up to the great powers. So that's a problem. That's something that we fortunately can fix. But before we fix anything, before I even show you how to confirm that my claims are true, I think it's worth it for us to have a brief conversation about the way the AI works in regards to using its construction sectors. This is going to be assuming that you're playing with the autonomous construction. If you're not playing with autonomous investment on, I really do think you should. I think it adds a lot of flavor to the game. It gives a lot of directionality and a lot of voice to capital inside of your society. And I don't know, like, I don't think I've ever interacted with a society where capital is happy to just sit around and do absolutely nothing. Coughs and 12 million investment pool in Persia. My goodness. And this is a problem because it means that there are going to be some countries that were diplomatically and economically important within this time frame that just never go anywhere. Part of that, of course, is based off of the AI strategy. When it comes to spending construction points, you, when you're the player, direct the government construction, and then the autonomous investment directs the private construction. The private construction is largely going to operate the same for player versus AI. It's going to be trying to invest the money that comes from the investment pool into things that in turn are going to be making the pops paying into the investment pool wealthier. Now, because one capitalist can't own a paper mill and a tooling workshop individually, you can't have those sort of like captains of industry. But I think the behavior of the capital is the thing that's important here. Capital coming from people who've made it and then being reinvested into things that are going to intentionally make them more powerful makes sense. And that's basically the way the private construction operates. If it has a way to make the pops who are currently paying into the investment pool, which is going to be mostly directed by the economic system in place, but also in turn determined by the dividends coming out of their buildings. So here you can see there are a lot of dividends coming out of the textile mills, and that in turn is going to make the investment pool a little more industrialist friendly in Persia than their agricultural investments government strategy. But it also means that the private construction is going to be able to identify things that are non-ideologically useful. So Persia will build things that are not agricultural, right? It's happy to build a food industry here, which is in turn going to make their interest groups a little different in terms of their strength. But it's not going to chase productivity the same way that a private construction would. And that means that the more private construction that you have going on inside of the world, the more that you'll get things like coal in abundance, right? If you're trading with a whole bunch of countries and all of those countries have a lot of construction sectors, those construction sectors will in turn chase some amount of return on investment. And if you're buying all of the coal from Peru, Bolivia, then the investment pool here in Peru, Bolivia could in turn build more coal. But if there's only 15 construction going on and only a handful of construction being allocated to private construction, then the capital can't do that. The capital, in fact, will basically do nothing. And that's a big problem because it means that the world economy, especially below great power, is very static and non-responsive when it comes to market pressures. Now, how do I know all of this? Well, it's because of the default construction sector AI that the game itself shows us. Let's just go over to Steam. Let's go to Properties, Installed Files, Browse. Then you open Game, Common, AI Strategies, and Default Strategy. This is the default strategy for all of the AI in Victoria 3. This is going to detail some diplomatic things, some economic things, ways that the AI interacts with its laws, ways that the AI interacts with different AI. And there's just like a lot of really useful information in here. So if you want to just read it on your own, I think you should. I think it tells you a lot about the way that the game simultaneously railroads, but also builds an interesting society around it. But we're just gonna search for construction here because this is gonna tell you everything that you need to know. Construction is enormously important in Victoria 3. It's the thing that determines the nature and form of your growth. And so the more construction that you can afford, the better. Now, of course, the more growth that you can afford, the more your society is gonna change. And so having some limits on construction sectors makes sense, especially in conservative societies, like small C conservative, because they'll resist efforts to change. But that's kind of what this thing tells you. Let's first talk about value equals zero. This means that all other things aside, an AI has absolutely no tolerance or desire for any construction sectors at all. I think this is inherently unrealistic, and one of those things that when you're modifying things at home, I think you should change this. If you want to make any sort of modifications here, just make a backup of the default strategy, so that way you can just revert it whenever you want to. But I really do think that changing this to 1, 2, or 3 produces a lot more realistic results. Because I think in every society which uses capital, there's going to be some natural demand for that capital to be reinvestable, no matter what size. And so by adding a small value here, you can kind of push AI in the direction of, okay, you have to start building things. Start changing your society. Now, that society is still going to be using its economic system to determine the nature and form of that private investment. So adding just a couple of construction sectors isn't necessarily going to unleash a wave of liberalism on the world that's going to transform your entire AI, but it will help the AI behave a little better. I did a 3-value, 0 investment pool run here that just ran until 1876. And you can see that it helped some of the countries build a little bit more, right? Persia is only down to 6.68 million in its investment pool instead of 12. But some of those things are just going to be purely random, right? It's going to depend on what sort of wild things happen in terms of your game. But having a small value here, no matter what you choose, I think does add a little more flavor to the game. And importantly, it gives mid-size AIs ways to get the ball rolling. Because the real thing that's going to be determining the size of the AI construction sectors under default rules is going to be GDP and total population. You can see here that they naturally add 1 to this value as a back-end calculation per 2 million GDP, and then another 1 per 2 million pop, but it's also going to be multiplied by 0.75 if it has traditionalism as a law. I think that's good for 2 reasons. I think it, 1, shows that in a traditionalist economy, the power of capital is going to be lower, but it also kind of helps the AI broadly, because in a traditionalism law economy, it's going to have less money to throw around. And so if you take this away, not only do you lose some flavor, but I think the AI will perform worse. It'll probably end up doing debt construction a lot more often. Same here with land-based taxation and consumption-based taxation. I think this makes sense, mostly for the economic side than anything else. But of course, if land-based taxation is in place, then peasants are paying a lot in taxes, the people who have political power inside the society and therefore are directing the flow of investment pool and capital, they're going to resist changes to the number of peasants. So having a multiplier that's 0.75 makes sense. Here's another important thing. The game does afford more construction sectors to AIs that are trying to do resource expansion or industrial expansion. That's good for 2 reasons. 1, those buildings are going to take more construction points. Therefore, they're going to need more construction sectors to accomplish their strategy. But 2, I think largely these strategies tell you that the government itself is more interested in the industrialization of the world than in keeping growth down, right? Agricultural strategies and plantation strategies intentionally are conservative, whereas these are intentionally not. So using more construction sectors makes sense. But here's two of the really big ones. So if the AI has a strategy placate population, it's only 0.5. And if it's maintaining Mandate of Heaven, it's only 0.1. So this is a huge deal when it comes to the way the AI works, because this means that Qing is basically going to have a very small construction sector as long as it is in Mandate of Heaven. And this means that a lot of the conservative, like very, very conservative AI in placate population are intentionally going to be cutting down on construction, and therefore keeping their taxes lower, therefore keeping the population happier. So I think that largely this construction sector AI makes sense and does a lot of things well, but it doesn't do one thing well in a very big way. So let's go ahead and add something to this. So highlight this, copy it, paste it back in, but instead of it being total population, let's add investment pool. And then you can do this divide by whatever. If you want to do like 1 million, I think that makes sense, because investment pool doesn't just represent capital that's demanding that the government make more construction sectors and therefore allow it to operate on the society more. But just from a back-end financials perspective for the AI, GDP and total population don't really tell you about the health of the economy for the AI in question. Doesn't really tell you if you can afford another construction sector or not. Investment pool, on the other hand, very much does, right? The more investment pool that you have, the more underutilized construction has to be inside of your society. Because the only way for you to be growing your investment pool to 6 million or 115 million is if you're building so few buildings that your private construction isn't going into the negative. There are, of course, costs to the government to expanding construction sectors, so it's not entirely free, so you don't want to just make this like one. But the more investment pool you have, the more the society can actually afford to build stuff. So this is a save file where I set investment pool to 500,000 and then value to zero. And you can see here that in this society, we've allowed a little more construction to occur. So the Dutch East Indies are up to 54 construction here. They're chewing through their investment pool instead of just floating at millions. Same with the Spanish Philippines. Look, they're up to 55 construction. But this is pretty important because it means that some of the smaller and mid-sized economies, when you interact with them more as a player and therefore give them access to more money in their investment pool, they will in turn produce more things. So here's a save file, conversely, that we edited to 1 million investment pool and 3 as a base value. You can see it resulted in a world where Argentina actually built 6 construction sectors, Sokoto has 5, Persia has 16. But critically, I want to highlight making changes to this default strategy isn't necessarily going to imbalance the economies of the world. Because keep in mind that these larger economies are not just going to be following this default strategy, they also have some logic behind the scenes on just trying to balance their budget to an extent. And of course, as you build more, as your construction sectors get larger and larger, the construction sectors are going to keep the investment pool down. And so the investment pool, I think, is one of those things that, if I had to guess, I think Paradox probably just forgot to include it as part of the update that included autonomous investment, because I don't think it really hurts the main goal of a lot of these small C conservative societies. The way that the autonomous investment behaves means that there's still a lot of flavor to the way societies develop. But it also means that these mid-size economies just build so much better. Sokoto's up to 7.64 million GDP in this run, and it's still building. The Dutch East Indies are at 16.8 million. Argentina has almost built away all of its peasants here. So I'm going to encourage you to just go in and modify the AI in a way that introduces investment pool. It really does improve the behavior of the AI in regards to construction, but that also means that the AI is going to have less control over its own society, right? the more private construction going on, the more potential there is for dramatic social change. Especially if you're there in the game trying to trade with and interact with the AI, right? Like Argentina here, if we were to be playing in the game, they'd be making a lot more money because I would be importing their sugar and their paper and their fabric because I'd be in free trade at this point just buying all their crap. And that would mean that the buildings that they've got here in Argentina would be making a lot more money and therefore actually making more investment pool and building more. But you can also add different laws here if you want to make the AI more responsive. I think if you wanted to add a law type for a greater demand for construction sectors under laissez-faire, I think that would probably be useful. But there are lots of different ways that you can modify the construction sectors at home. I would just make sure that you got this backup. But I do think broadly, including something in your investment pool for the AI makes a lot of sense. Because without making any modifications, if you just leave the default the way that it is, investment pool and capital itself has absolutely no influence on governments or societies. It doesn't tell society, hey, we're ready to make money, let's grow. And that doesn't really describe the nature of the world here particularly well. If you're wealthy and you have money and you're an aristocrat in Persia, it doesn't matter if by building something you're going to marginally decrease your strength. You want money, right? And because of the way that the construction works, it's not like the landowners really lost that much clout as a result of us changing the AI here. But it does mean just a lot more responsiveness out of your trade partners, because private construction is intentionally going to be building things that make money. And so if you buy everybody's iron, you know, the private construction will go out and build more iron. So it's sort of like a way to do foreign investment. So yeah, let me know if you make any modifications to your default construction sector AI and what you think about this. We're just finishing up the move right now, but hopefully we'll be back to doing some more regular recordings next week. All right, that's Walker. Take care.